Good morning, everybody. This is our first show of Wake the Fuck Up with Jeff. And it's an experiment. We'll try it. First part of the experiment is I'll probably do it at 8 a.m. instead of 7. I mean, I'm up at 3 or 4, but just to get my normal schedule and Angelo's schedule in routine, I figure I'll do this at 8 instead. Also, works around his homeschooling. When we started. So anyway, the reason why I wanted to do this show, I've always wanted to do a different show besides Q&A. I love the Q&A show. I love the Real Talk show. I love all the different shows that I do with Joelle. Joelle didn't want to be interested in this show at all because, you know, I'd probably go off on rants, piss off a lot of people. But maybe it's time to start waking people up. And I think that's what needs to happen. I'm actually highly concerned about the dog training industry right now on many, many different levels. Everything from laws being passed to tools being banned. But the number one thing I'm really, really concerned about is what is happening in the minds of dog owners. And how did we get so many badly behaved dogs, dysfunctional dogs? Untrained dogs is not even the issue. That's easy to do. Training is easy to do. But how do we get to the point where dogs are so mentally unstable? Physically sound, that's a breeder issue, and that's not one I'm going to I don't go, I have no problem with breeders. I don't like bad breeding, but breeders are not my thing. I'm more concerned, actually, believe it or not, about rescue. And this is not all rescues. Whenever I put something up about rescues, some of my rescue colleagues who I actually get along with, like, you know, will like start hating me. And I'm like, I wasn't talking about you. You should know that. And I always even say this. I always say not all rescues, not all shelters. I think most shelters are doing the best they can, but they could be doing better by allowing people to adopt dogs and train them any way they want to, but that could be a whole nother show. But the big thing is the denial. As someone who's been doing this for 20 years, I've been training for 20 years. I've been training lots of dogs for 20 years, probably over 10,000, most likely over 10,000 dogs. I've traveled the world training dogs. Right now I'm staying in actually just the United States because of my vaccine status. I cannot actually go to Canada, and there's many countries I actually can't go to, even though I just came back from Greece, which was actually really, really nice. I encourage people to do it. If anybody else wants to go, let me know. It does not have to be expensive. Housing is expensive. Food does not have to be. But one of my big concerns is a couple of things. I'm not sure how I'm going to format this show yet, so I'm going to play around a little bit with it. But let's talk about one thing that comes to mind about what I would be considered an issue of the human psychology, the human mentality around the lack of human compassion and for humans, lack of human compassion. Yeah, that would be human. And how dogs are all innocent and they should all live and never be put down. And if you decide to put a dog down, you're evil. I saw something on social media. It was a post, and I unfriend so many people because I don't want this stuff going in my head, but I'm going to see a lot of stuff anyway because people send me stuff. Someone, imagine this scenario. You see three dogs on the side of the road. The kindness of your heart picks them up, puts them in your car. You take them home. Imagine in the first 5 minutes of those dogs being at your house, and you know nothing about these dogs, they kill your cat. So that happens in the first 5 minutes. Then imagine that they start fighting with each other. And you try to break it up, and you get bit. This is all happening in the first hour to 2 hours of you bringing these dogs home. Then imagine they start taking over your house because you're not set up for these dogs. So what do? You contact a local friend of yours who actually is in rescue. And you just write them a short little email saying, you know, this is what's going on, and could you please help me? Then the rescue person puts up the post explaining that, you know, the friend of theirs is looking to find placement for these three dogs. And 99% of the comments on this post were literally blaming this dude, calling this person unloving, uncaring, selfish. That is the attitude of dog people. Not all dog people, but a lot of dog people. And the first thought that came into my mind is, are you fucking serious? Are you fucking serious? You put yourself into this person's shoes. These dogs killed this man's cat immediately. They immediately start fighting. They immediately start making him feel unsafe in his own home. Monday, everything was fine. Tuesday, fucking shit show. And he's the bad guy? This is the mentality that's going on out there. This is literally, people will crucify this person. And I'm like, put the dogs back on the damn road. Drop the dogs off at a shelter. Oh, that's terrible. Think about that. Think about all this stuff rationally. And no one is thinking of this stuff rationally. And just FYI, I'm not looking at the comments now because this is not going to be as much of a Q&A, but I will address them at some point, possibly. I am highly concerned about that mentality, and this mentality is all over the place. So that's one small example of what is going on in the dog world. That dogs can do no harm. Sounds like a lot of harm in that situation, doesn't it? And humans are evil unless they keep that these dogs to the end of their natural life, no matter how much damage it does to them, to their dogs, to their kids, to their house. That's it. That's the logic out there. That's the psychotic logic out there. And we can go pretty deep into that if we want to. And I've done it on some of my other shows about, like, why would somebody blame this person? Why would somebody hate this person? Why would somebody think this person is doing wrong? I think this person should get rid of these dogs immediately. And I really don't care how they do it. That does not mean I'm a dog lover. I've spent my life rehabbing and keeping dogs in homes. But I'm also a realist. So there's something called accountability. He thought he was doing the right thing. That doesn't mean he should spend the next 10 years trying to work it out. It means it's like, well, that didn't work. Oh, well, sorry, dogs. You got to go somewhere else. It's not like he got a dog from a breeder or a rescue or like a puppy. He picked them off from the side of the road, as many of us would. I just find it really, really interesting. So how did this all start? How did we get into this shit show of dogs? Okay, new topic. We're seeing so many dogs right now that are just so aggressive, so mentally unstable. And I talk to the owners, and the owners are really good people. I talk to a lot of great people, wonderful people. I don't owner shame at all. But it's time that folks started looking things more rationally than emotionally. And that's what makes this whole industry hard. Over 20 years, I've probably talked to, oh, I don't know, 80,000 people, right? I mean, yesterday I talked to five. How many is that a day? I mean, a week? How many is that a year? I don't know. Sometimes I talk to more. At seminars, I talk to a lot more. But so many people have aggressive dogs, and they'll use their dog's description as sweet, smart. And if you apply to us, and if you put that in there, I'm not going to hate you. I'm not going to think badly of you. What I do, though, is I say to you is your dog is biting your children. You can't use the word sweet in the description of your dog. And I'll get a response usually like, well, no, but he's loving. He comes up on the couch and he snuggles with me. And I'm like, but that's not why you're calling me. You're calling me because your dog bites your kids. So that's the denial part. That's what's keeping people from doing the right work. That is honestly what it is. That is what is keeping people from correcting their dog, from serving their dog properly. Like the dog, so what you're saying is the dog is meeting your human emotional needs, therefore it's sweet. Let's just think about this. I'm not passing judgment. You please don't pass judgment. But let's think about things more logically. Let's also be honest with ourselves. Your dog is meeting your emotional needs. Therefore, it's a sweet dog. But the way I'm looking at it, and chances are your friends are looking at it, and maybe even someone else in your house is looking at it, is this is not a sweet dog. The dog is biting the kids. Why would we allow these dogs to biting the kids? Now, you're calling us for help. So no shit. We're going to help if we can. But we'll only help if the owner changes their mindset. So we don't take every dog. Because if the owner can't change their mindset, the dog will not change. It'll do great for us, which is another big lie in the industry. Of course, the dog will do great for the trainer historically, because the trainer has a set of skill sets and they're not emotionally connected to the dog. That doesn't mean they don't care about the dog. It means they don't have the owner-dog relationship. And they're also not in denial. Because when you work with challenging dogs, when you work with hard dogs, you have to be a realist. You also have a job to do. You have to make the dog safe. You have to educate the human. And the best way to do it is before, as far as educating the human, is before the dog enters your facility to make sure the dog is actually doing properly. But more and more and more people, and I don't know if this started with this whole COVID thing, which locked everybody up, and everybody struggled and they needed some sort of emotional support and they got a dog and all they did was baby the dog and they ignored all the bad things. And now 2 to 3 years later, here we are with the biggest fucking shit show I've ever seen in my 20-year career. And I don't believe that it's dogs that have changed. I believe that it's humans that have changed. Sure, dogs are not coming out as good as they used to. But, and it's also like, we'll talk about puppy mills on this show because I'm not anti and that'll piss people off. I'm all for quality breeding. If you didn't know, my oldest dog girl is no longer with me. I had to put her down 3 days prior to us leaving for out of country because she was horribly sick. She's 12 years old, was not doing better. And I made that decision. But so I'm looking for another dog. I probably will buy my dog from a quality breeder and I'll get a ton of shit from that. I work with a lot of German shepherds. There's a lot of messed up German shepherds out there. I work with them. So why is it that we're ignoring reality at the danger of our children and not literally honestly saying, I own a dangerous dog, so I'm going to do something about it. But let's please stop saying your dog is sweet and loving and smart and knows it did wrong and wants to be a good boy, wants to be a good girl. Your dog bit your kids. Your dog bites everybody that comes in your house. Three people I talked to yesterday, they can't have anybody come into their home. They can't have anybody come into their home. They cannot go anywhere because they can't leave the dog alone because it destroys everything. Those two things alone, that's enough for me to start the conversation. How could you call dogs like that sweet, loving, smart? That sounds like dogs that are destroying your life. That sounds like dogs that are destroying your life. That's got to stop. So how do we get there? How do we stop it? What do we do? Number one, what do you think we do when a dog first comes into our facility? What do you think we do? Well, the first thing we do is not love the dog. That doesn't mean we don't care about the dog. We have a limited time to work with these dogs. The best thing to do is to put them into a structured program. What does that look like? Well, you can't be this out of control dog that you're used to being. So we want to put a stop to that immediately. How do we do that? Leash pop, bonker. We'll go on the whole bonker rant another show. Then we get them to respect thresholds. You don't rush through thresholds. You actually don't pull me. Two things, two leadership things. You're not allowed to pull on the leash. And I'm not talking about the walk. I'm just talking about pulling on the leash. You can't just go rushing through thresholds just because you want to get through a threshold. Then we do crate drills. How you go in a crate, how you go out of a crate. How you go in a crate, how you go out of a crate. Everything is based on impulse control, structure, leadership. A lot of folks have a hard time with the word leadership. Why do you think that is? Why do you think people have a hard time with leadership? Because that brings back old, unresolved memories, most likely, from when they were growing up or from partners they've had, romantic partners they've had, possibly employers, quote unquote, bosses that they've had, anger towards them. And that's why the word leadership is a hot point for them. It's a hot button, leadership. But it's your job to be your dog's leader. You're not a pet parent, by the way. Your dog is not your child. I put up a post about that yesterday. Man, did that strike a lot of people's nerves. They were mad at me. It's like, don't be mad at me. Because the post hit home, don't be mad at me. Because reality finally struck you in the face, don't be mad at me. Maybe you should sit back and you should say, wow, let me think about this a little bit differently. Then we start the dogs on a series of highly structured obedience. What do? Teach them the basics. Meanwhile, if any unwanted behaviors creep up, what do? We correct them. Yep, we apply a punisher. Any dog trainer out there, any of all this information out there that says reward-based only is bullshit. I've said it many times before, and I will say it again, it is bullshit. And that is one of the biggest lies out there in this industry. Anybody that says that they have fully trained their dog to any capacity ever and never applied a consequence, punisher, correction is an outright blatant liar. Any high-level competition dog, you're a real big liar. You might not think you did, but you did. You might not have called it that, but it is that. And then you talk to some folks about like, well, I was able to train my dog and I didn't need to use any of that shock collar, prong collar. That's fine. We don't have to either. We're just trying to help owners out, give them some leverage. But you applied a consequence. There was a punisher. Or maybe there wasn't and your dogs are out of control, but they meet your emotional needs. See, everybody has a different bar set. Everybody has a different bar set. So for instance, Tex, he's my Malinois. Right now he's the only dog I have. I've gone down from 12 to 8 to 6 to 4 to 3 to 2 to 1, since a lot of you have followed me. And he went outside this morning when I told him to. He didn't tell me when he wanted to go outside. I'm not talking about puppies. I'm talking about a grown dog. I know his schedule. Came back in. He ate breakfast outside, by the way. We feed raw. So eat your raw food outside. I don't want it in the house. All over the floor. So he eats it outside. Comes back in. Saw that I was doing a podcast. And then my microphone is falling. And then comes in, lies down right next to me. Don't even tell him to do it. Why? Because we've done it lots of times. So training a series of events. And then also, we need consistency. Dogs are getting mixed messages. So I feel, my opinion, based on thousands and thousands of clients, thousands and thousands of dogs, thousands and thousands of phone calls, traveling the world, is because we as owners have become soft. We as owners are in denial. We as owners are not being realists. We as owners are babying our dogs. We are not holding them accountable. And now we're left with dangerous dogs. So if you talk to anybody in the industry that does behavior modification, they actually work with dogs. They will tell you they are seeing more dangerous dogs than ever before. Why? It's not a breeding issue. It's not a backyard breeding issue. I've gotten dogs from backyard breeders. They were great dogs. I work with dogs from the people paid $5,000, $10,000 for that are all messed up. It's not a backyard breeder problem. A lot of people are against puppy mills. A lot of people are against backyard breeders. And I say to myself, that's really interesting because they'll use the word hate. They use the word hate. And they'll rally on shutting them all down. And then I ask a rational question because I'm a rational human being. I say, Do you own a dog? Oh, yeah. I said, do you love your dog? Oh, we love our dog. Okay. Where did you get that dog from? Oh, we rescued it. You didn't rescue it. You bought it. You bought it from a shelter. You bought it from a rescue. It's a financial transaction, which is fine. Let's just admit it. It doesn't mean the places are bad, but money has exchanged hands. Unless you found the dog on the side of the street and just kept it. You still didn't rescue it. You just didn't pay for it. And I said, where do you think that dog comes from? Just think about it logically. Where do you think the dog that was sitting in the shelter came from? The one you love. The one you love. Your best friend. The one that goes everywhere with you. The one that lives with your family. The one that you possibly treat like a family member. Where do you think that dog comes from? Do you think it comes from a high-quality breeder? I doubt it. Do you think it comes from a puppy mill? Most likely. Backyard breeder? Probably. So the two things that you hate the most, you actually own. And you love. So if it wasn't for all these backyard breeders and puppy mills, that doesn't mean, rah, rah, Jeff's a big fan of them. I'm just a realist. You wouldn't have that dog. Just think about that. Just think about that. And shutting down all these backyard breeders and puppy mills is not going to solve a problem. And we know why. Why? Because so many shelters and rescues have made it so difficult for folks to adopt dogs. That does not mean everyone. So all the ones that I get along with that like me, okay, that I work with, okay, obviously I'm working with you for a reason because you have a different mentality. And of course you want to make sure the dog's going to a good home, but how would you know? But sometimes, and if you talk to enough people, they'll tell you that it's almost, that's the wrong word. It is so difficult to get a dog from a rescue, from a shelter. I understand why. They want to make sure the dog is well taken care of. I get it. So do most breeders. I get it. But when you have got all these dogs being dropped off at shelters where they're kept in kennels almost 24/7, isn't taking a chance on an owner a better option? And I really feel deeply that most people are going to try their best. But shelters need to stop having such stringent adoption policies and also stop putting in these little disclaimers, if that's what the right word is, about how you train your dog. Because if they don't want to see that dog back, they should let their owner train that dog any way they want to. Because one of the biggest reasons why dogs are in shelters is not from bad dog owners. It's not from overbreeding. It's from the messaging that people are getting out there that is not allowing owners to train the dogs how they want to, which means they're all preaching reward-based only. And we all know that has limitations. That has limitations. We train reward-based. That's how we train all of our obedience. But that is where it stops. You're not going to reward the dog out of being aggressive. And if someone says that they do, they're full of fucking shit. They just are. Tell me step by step how you do it. Because I don't believe you. I don't believe you. Nobody believes you. Well, some people do. But a lot of people don't. Because they know it doesn't work. What do we got here? Let's go through some of these. I don't have Joelle here, so I'm on my own. Oy, oy, oy. Good morning, Africa. How are you? Hey, Raquel, how are you? So here's something. Raquel, on her page, just put up, she's a wonderful, wonderful trainer in Brazil. She just sent me a wonderful thing from her stories of her at a shooting range. Beautiful, beautiful video. Raquel, how much hate did you get for that? I don't know what the climate is in Brazil, but, you know, up here in the States, stuff like that, it's terrible. Stuff like that would be like, oh my gosh, a female is shooting a gun at a shooting range. Yeah. Have you ever thought that, like, everybody should start learning how to, like, take care of themselves, protect themselves? Are we not aware of what's going on out there? But Drazzy Ant Girl, it's actually late here. It's already 7:42 in the morning. Late for me. The show's going to be starting at 8, though, as I mentioned earlier, if you're just tuning in, just because of my scheduling. Portugal, you're doing a public service to the world. Thanks, you, Jeff. You must know that. Well, I think I'm doing the right thing. Thank you. I think I'm doing the right thing. It's always funny when I get hate. I can write a book on that. It's always funny when I get hate because Everybody likes to throw the abuse word out. Everybody loves to put the link to that. I call it a fake bonking video. And the reason why it's fake is because that, of course, is me in it. It's my fucking video. It's a 20-minute video with no context. Actually, it's a made-up context. And everybody likes to run with that story. Everybody. Nobody likes to look into things. So I think I'm doing a good service. Thank you, Lisa. Figure out how this scrolling works here. Drazzy Ant Girl, it's not uncommon. Yeah. Cats as well. I don't know as much about cats, Cheryl. I don't know as much about cats. What I will say, though, is in Greece, man, there are some cats everywhere. Not some. There's a lot of cats everywhere. A lot of cats. Joelle found a special cat named Jackie. She first called it Captain Jack, but then realized it was a female. Not that females can't be captains, but back in the day in the pirate ships, I don't think they had that equal opportunity. I think. Hold on here. Just turn on my water here. Drinking some tea. Was that lemon tea? Gave up coffee. Man, I like to start again. But let's see how that goes. So I don't know as much about the cat world as anything. Preach for the people, Marina. Preach for the people. For the people in the back. I don't. Yeah, I think it's getting better, but I also think it's getting worse. I mean, more and more people are realizing that it's not working. Reward only is not working. But the messaging that they have, the power that they have, is incredible. The marketing machine that they have is incredible. If you hear that little buzzing in the background, that's it's my little hot pot there that I am restocking my tea with. The messaging of and making people that use a correction, it's just so evil. It's just so evil. You become this evil human being for doing it. And it's so funny because nobody has an alternative. So they'll tell you to do something, but they don't have an alternative for it. Terry says she sees this all on her local pages, sad for all the hate. Well, we do get a lot of hate, but that comes with the territory, I guess. But it shouldn't, right? It shouldn't come with the territory. I don't go on to people. I think the people that write hate on your page, it's more about them than it is about you. So instead of me, I see a lot of stuff that I don't like on social media. But I never comment anything negative on social media. I'll just maybe make a post on my own page in my words. But I won't attack somebody. But let's say I do get hate, which I do. And then I just ask a simple question. Simple question. Can you please tell me step by step how to rehab an aggressive dog? That's a simple question for someone in my industry that works with aggressive dogs. And I'll say, I'll even make it simpler for you. This is a great question to ask any dog trainer. How do you stop a dog from jumping on a human being the first time? The first time. It can't happen at all. The dog weighs 100 pounds. A child weighs, is 4 years old, or grandmother is in her 80s. So the dog can't jump on them. It's a 100-pound dog. So how do you stop it one time? Just tell me step by step. Any decent dog trainer can do that in one time. We never have dogs jump on us. Think about that. My dog's been jumping on people for 2 years, comes into us, and it doesn't jump on anybody here or anybody in our facility. Why? Why? It's not that hard to do. You can stop jumping easier than training a reliable sit. And then people will say, Well, that's because you inflict pain to it. You make it afraid. Those are these words that are thrown out there. I'm like, well, let's see. Inflict discomfort, pain to a dog for jumping on a human for 3 seconds, 1 second, 2 seconds, or grandma gets knocked over, possibly dies, breaks her hip, goes to the emergency room, gets COVID in the hospital, dies from pneumonia. What would a rational human being do in this situation? A rational human being that actually realizes that dogs can do harm. This whole phrase that there's no bad dogs, bullshit. That dogs can do no harm, bullshit. That doesn't mean they shouldn't be given a chance, but I'm just saying those phrases are bullshit. Because there's badly behaved dogs and there's dangerous dogs out there. And there are dogs that actually should not be walking the face of the earth. This concept that every dog should be kept alive. Nope. This is going to piss off a lot of people. But we meet dogs that are outright vicious. And it's so funny because when somebody says what we're doing is wrong, and when I mention, well, what would you do in this situation? They'll say, well, put down the dog. So you're okay with killing the dog. Maybe the dog should be put down, but that's not the point. You're okay with killing the dog, but rehabbing the dog, even if it does create momentary points of discomfort, momentary points of fear, that's considered abuse, but killing the dog is acceptable. Let's just think about that rationally. Killing the dog is acceptable. Rehabbing the dog is abusive. So you want only perfect dogs and everyone else should be dead. Okay. Cheryl says, rather than help the person and the dogs, people just get on their soapbox with their limited mindset and create more problems. Yeah, I you're right. I get on my soapbox too. So I'm guilty as charged. But whether people respond to this messaging in a positive or negative way, is that really on me or is that on them? And I'm finding out the people, the best example was one of the posts I did yesterday about it's a dog. That hit so many people. I had to ban people because there's just so much attacking on me personally. And it's just like, it's my page. This isn't like CNN. It's not like a public page. You're on my page. Like, I won't have you in my house screaming and yelling at me either. And I'm all open for discussion. But so many people are just affected by this. And my first things are, well, maybe I am actually talking about you. Maybe not you personally, but the character traits you are, it's hitting too close to home and you're getting defensive instead of looking at it optimistically. Drazzy says a lot of rescue situations have become dangerous, wild animal handling instead. I don't know if that's right or fair for the human or the dog. I agree. You know, most rescue, I know of a couple of rescues that actually are doing a good job. They're actually doing a good job with rehab. They're actually doing a great job with fosters. They're actually doing a great job with training. But there's a lot of them that are literally just putting staff in danger. They're just putting staff in danger. Tracy. Hello, Tracy. I hope you're enjoying the Carolinas. One of my daughters actually just moved to your area, actually. I think people do need to be realistic on what's trainable, what's not trainable. And also you have to be realistic on a couple of things. Is there anybody by you that can actually do the work? Is there anybody, can you afford to do the work? And financially, and are you the human willing to do the aftercare? We always tell owners, all we're doing is giving you a head start. If you don't change your habits once the dog comes home, well, then you're going to get the same dog. It's going to revert back. Why wouldn't it? Why wouldn't it? Kathleen, I had a friend in rescue transport to me, a German Shepherd from rural Pennsylvania, which is puppy mill country, to my home in Virginia. Day one was great. Day two, she decided to not allow my husband and son come through the front door. I packed her up and drove 4 hours to return her to the rescue that she came from. I draw the line at temperament. My family must feel safe. A few weeks later, we drove to West Virginia, picked up a puppy and trained her ourselves. She's now 4 years old and is amazing. Yep. That's a great example. Kathleen, kudos to you. Kudos to you, Kathleen. How many people out there, though, would feel that Kathleen was selfish and terrible? But could you imagine that, owning a dog that doesn't allow one of your family members to come in through the front door? Now, can that be fixed? Sure. But that's not the point. That's not the point. The point is that people should be allowed to come in, especially family members, into their own home. And who are these dogs to not allow it? Now, again, well, the dog didn't know any better. Probably not. But maybe Kathleen didn't have the skill set, didn't have the knowledge, didn't have the budget to hire somebody. I don't blame her. You're not in her footsteps, in her shoes. You're not in her shoes. It's easy to blame an owner. It's easy to blame an owner. Carolyn. Hey, Carolyn, how are you? Carolyn is one of my OGs. I've known Carolyn for a very, very long time. Carolyn is a wonderful person, brain cancer survivor, has an organization. I've trained her dogs. Every one of her dogs is under 15 pounds. Small little, cute little things. You know, I'm a dog person. I love my dogs enough to train them. I don't love my dogs like I love humans. I treat dogs like dogs. People are treating dogs like they're human. Wake up. You can love your pets, but they're not human. Don't put humans in harm's way because you expect your dog to act like a human. They're animals derived from the wolf. I think that folks have got to really, really start realizing that they're animals. You're working with an animal. An animal that can kill you. An animal that can put harm on you. It's funny. Somebody put a post on my comment on my page. Well, children, they can rape and steal and kill. Well, dogs can create a divorce. They can actually kill, believe it or not. They can kill humans. All right. And they're not just all pit bulls, by the way. They can harm people. They can put people in the hospital. They can take your eyeball out. They can keep you from using your hand. They could. We have dogs. We have clients with dogs that couples can't hug each other without getting bit. Could you imagine that? You can't hug your spouse if your dog is in the same room or you will get bit. And everybody's quick, well, if it bites the husband must have done something to it. Well, the way we look at it is no, it resource guards the other person. Let's say it's a male-female relationship, so it resource guards the female. The husband didn't do anything wrong. It just resource guards the female. So anybody getting close to the female, it bites. Now, that's fixable. We do it all the time. Is it going to be pretty? Nope. But either is biting the husband. Either is divorce court, financially, emotionally, everything. Sarah, genetics matter. Absolutely, genetics matter. But Sarah, here's a good question, though. Do you think in the last 10 years, genetics have changed that dramatically? Or do you think human behavior has changed dramatically? The messaging of reward only has become more powerful. Social media has grown in 10 years, which is creating a shit show of bad training advice. Some say it comes from me. So, Sarah, you're right. Genetics do matter. But has the genetic pool changed that much in the last 10 years? Because you can take a dog, and this is always a great example. You can take a dog. We take dogs from families to train them, and they'll do perfectly fine with us. But with the owners, they're horrific. So we have dogs that come into our facility that the owners say they don't want anymore. We don't take those dogs because we don't rehome dogs. But we work with them and we're like, this is a great dog. Wow, I would actually keep this dog. So just think about that. The owner thinks it's the worst dog ever. We think it's an awesome dog. It's the same genetics. Why? Why? So Cheryl, a lot of the unstable dogs we're seeing has to do with bad breeding, puppy mill and backyard breeder dogs, as well as the movement to remove every possible way we have to change behavior. So Cheryl, I highly agree with your second comment. You know, Joelle had a, I've also gotten dogs from backyard breeders that were great dogs. They were wonderful dogs. One of my best dogs was from a backyard breeder. Best dog I ever had was from a backyard breeder. And I work with a lot of dogs. So compared to a lot of the dogs that I work with over the last 20 years, probably in the top five dogs I've ever worked with. And I own that dog, and I got that dog from a backyard breeder. Joelle got a dog, her lab, who's unfortunately not with us anymore, from a backyard breeder. I don't know what you paid for it, $25. Great dog. Great dog. So, but then definitely the second part on dogs being limited and humans being limited, I mean, on what they can and cannot do, has been a problem. Cheryl, because giving your cookie to a dog all the time is the only nice way to train it. It doesn't always work with difficult, dangerous dogs. It actually never works. You know, I shouldn't say never. The majority of the time, top 90%. So we food train dogs, but you need to stop the unwanted behavior first if you're doing behavior modification. I think folks need to understand the difference between obedience and behavior modification. And most dog trainers are doing, what the heck is going on with my mic? Most trainers are doing just basic obedience. They're not doing behavior modification. And sometimes behavior modification is not pretty. A lot of folks struggle with that. A lot of folks struggle with all those things. And it's too bad because you're not looking at the big picture. You're not looking at the big picture. And you're using too much of your emotional self and not your rational self when you're looking at things. And you usually don't know the whole picture at all. You're seeing clips. You're seeing little clips. It's no different than seeing a clip of a couple out for a romantic dinner and everybody's like, oh, that's so nice. But you're not seeing what goes on in the four walls of their home. The yelling, the screaming, the mental and physical abuse. Nobody's putting that up on Instagram until after the fact. And that just might be also for victim mentality. Good morning, Sandy. And Anne goes, people refer to dogs as old, as a year, as a puppy. And excuse the biting by calling it, you know, puppy biting. Yeah. Puppy biting, we eliminate puppy biting usually in 1 to 2 sessions. And we do it through a punisher. And that's another thing is the word punisher is not abuse. That's on you if you call it abuse. That's on you. It's called reality. It's also called dog training. And no one is taking responsibility for that. Just I'll call whatever you want to, but it's the action that's still the same. I can sugarcoat it, but I'm not going to sugarcoat it. And same thing with e-collars. People call them happy collars. Because if you use the word shock collar, it's bad. But all shock remote e-collars that have been manufactured from Garmin, Sport Dog, Dogtra, and e-collar technology in the last 5 years, if not longer, there's no shock collar. It's just not, you know, but you can call what you want. I call them shock collars. I call them remote collars. But I don't try to sugarcoat it. I'll call the word punishment a correction, an intolerable consequence. This is wordplay. This is wordplay. But everybody's always worried about the whole, like, wordplay, how it sounds. Why can't we be more focused on the results? Pia, such a complex and multi-layered issue. No one wants to be shamed on social media. No one wants to appear unloving towards the dog. Too many decisions being made from an emotional perspective, forgetting that a dog is not a person. I mean, I agree with you, Pia. I mean, but this is the thing. There's a... Joel is in... Joelle is in Rhode Island, and I've texted her this morning. There's only one way to avoid criticism. Do nothing, say nothing, and be nothing. Do nothing, say nothing, and be nothing. So by just doing this show, it's just giving more ammunition to the haters to take clips out of this, make their little edited videos, and then put it out there. And I like to think people are smart enough to see through all that. But for some reason, people are not. They're not. Like, this show is not geared towards how to train obedience. My Q&A, it's a problem-solving show. My seminars, it's a problem-solving show. So again, I'm opening myself up to even more criticism, to more hate, by doing a show like this. But I feel so powerful to change things that I will do this show and put myself in the line of fire to change the way that people start thinking about dogs. And what I'd like people to do is to start really thinking about the toll of having a badly behaved dog is having on your life. And that doesn't mean you should get rid of the dog, but what are you willing to do to change it? It's no different than getting healthy, losing weight, stopping smoking. I mean, I was exhausted this morning. I was beyond exhausted, probably still jet lagged. And I gave up coffee a while ago. I've been sober for over 30 years. I gave up coffee, 3 months ago. And I was like, man, I'm so tired. I've got this podcast. What a great time to start drinking coffee. And guess what? Here I am with my tea, caffeine free. It's called discipline. And I'm sorry to hear about girl. Yeah, Andrezzi and girl said the same thing. Yeah, girl was, she's older than Angelo. She's the first dog that Angelo ever petted. And he was 8 months old when he first petted a dog. And it was girl. See that cool little video I put up of Ange yesterday? Snorkeling? I'll put up another video today of him just diving into the pool fully underwater. Up until a month ago, he wouldn't even put anything below his chin underwater. He's got this weird thing with water on his head. But I got him a pair of goggles, and now he's just having fun. We're getting him ready for Greece for next year so we can go snorkeling. Renee, the reason so many people are having a hard time is because people have humanized animals, but I find that people treat dogs better than their kids. Yeah, I think, or they don't even have children. So I just think that they're humanizing dogs too much instead of, but even then, it's like, if you want to humanize your dog, would you allow a human to get away with what your dog is doing? So would you let your kids destroy their room? Would you let your kids, let's say we are humanizing dogs. Great point. If you want to humanize dogs, you go right ahead. You're making a big mistake, but go right ahead. Somebody walks in the front door. Your child, who's 100 pounds, walks over to that guest within the first 3 seconds and punches them in the face. And you grab your dog and you just, your kid, and you tell your kid to go to the room. And tomorrow, they do the same behavior. So if we want to talk about that, let's talk about that. Like, I can play the human game all day long because it's all based on behavior. Would you allow your child to punch your guest in the face as soon as they walked in the door? Yes or no? I'd like to think everybody said no. Well, why are we allowing our dogs to do this and why are we not doing anything else? Now, can you put a shock collar on your kid? Many people probably would like to, but no, you can't. But you can talk to your child, reason with your child, explain to your child, get special help with your child. But with a dog, it's a lot simpler. You just make that behavior suck, and the dog stops. Cheryl, oh my God, that's a perfect point. I just worked with a couple where the wife thinks the dog is her baby. She wonders why I can get the dog to work properly, et cetera, and she can't. Yeah. And this is the problem is, like, dogs aren't babies. Like, that's probably the biggest issue we're seeing right now in the dog training world is the humanization of dogs, the lack of consequences in dogs, the bad messaging that's being portrayed on social media that dogs can do no harm. Like, those three things combined is literally creating a massive shit show. And all that can be reversed by just a different thought process from the owner. All of it. Dogs are really good at meeting owners' emotional needs. And I get it. We got dogs for companionship. I get it. I understand. But also, the dog has to be held accountable. quality breeders are different than puppy mills. 100%. I agree with you 100%. But on the other hand, believe it or not, there's a lot of great dogs out there, and they didn't all come from quality breeders. But quality breeders definitely is a plus. That's why I'm looking for my next dog from a quality breeder. But there are good dogs in shelters that came from who knows where. Who knows where. But there's a big difference. There's a big difference. It's not as much as of a crapshoot usually. And then Beverly's like, on the flip side, if owners were taught how to own a dog in training, we wouldn't have many issues that are presented, and that dog is bad. Correct. But Beverly, this is the problem out there. The information is out there. See, the information is out there on how to create a great dog. But owners are not following that, and they'd rather go with what meets their emotional needs. That's the problem we're having. That's why we've got a problem in so many different categories in life. So we actually, as humans, have control over this. We have control. We can actually control the outcome historically of our dog's behavior. We actually can. We actually can. So a lot more comments. But so I think it's time for me to go. It's been an hour. It's time for me to go. I got to get Angelo. We have to exercise Tex now. Got to feed Ange, get him ready for school. Homeschool, still the same thing as school. All right. So this was the first edition. I'm still trying to figure this all out. There'll be many, many more after this. I have no idea how I'm going to do it. I'm just going to play it by ear. But I think conversations need to be happening about why dogs are so messed up right now, why owners are struggling so messed up. I'm envisioning doing single or double subjects. Anybody that thinks what I do is abuse, and my fellow trainers that think is abuse, I invite you on my show. We can do a side-by-side for a discussion. And you, if you're going to sit there and just call me a dog abuser, you'll be kicked off, because that's not what I'm interested in. But my big issue is, do you actually understand what we are doing? Do you know what we are doing? Do you know the dogs we work with? For folks that think that throwing a cotton towel at a dog that wants to literally kill or harm a dog or a human is abusive, baffles my mind. And everybody loves to run with that highly edited video. Everybody loves to run with it. But and then you got your fellow trainers out there that love to jump on the bandwagon. They hate how Jeff trains. Well, you actually don't know how I train. You just hear little snippets from social media, snippets from a problem-solving seminar. So for instance, before I close, you hear about stopping unwanted behavior, but you don't hear about how I train behaviors. You don't hear about all the play that I do, all the off-leash activities that I do. Like, I'm about to go biking with Tex. We're going to go bike around the neighborhood. He's going to be off-leash. He'll stay right at my side. Is that a problem? Nope. Whether he's leashed or unleashed. He went swimming 5 times yesterday. Is that a problem? Nope. Now, how did I teach him to swim? The first time, I used compulsion. But 3 or 4 years later, I'm not sure how long I've owned Tex. I'm bad with that stuff. He's been swimming almost every day of his life, multiple times. So what's one day of firmness for a lifetime of happiness? That might be a good close. What's one day of firmness for a lifetime of happiness? I hope you all well. Let's all put positivity out there. Let's try to think of things that are positive. Let's put positive stuff in our brains. All of us are struggling. Don't be fooled by social media. Everybody out there is struggling. Let's put positive stuff in our brains. Let's help other people that need it. Just always remember there are people out there that are doing worse than you. So let's all be kind. Love you all. Bye-bye.